Unaccountable. Dr. Wedel is a professor of international commerce and policy in the School of Public Policy at George Mason University. A social anthropologist by training, she writes about governance, development, foreign policy, and corruption through the lens of social anthropology. Her book, Collision and Collusion, The Strange Case of Western Aid to Eastern Europe in 2001, won the Gravemeyer Award for Ideas Improving World Order. She has been a four-time Fulbright Fellow, has won awards from the National Science Foundation, the MacArthur Foundation, the Ford Foundation, the German Marshall Fund, the United States Institute of Peace, and the Woodrow Wilson International Center for Scholars, and has been an associate producer of three PBS documentaries. Perhaps closest to our heart, she has been a senior research fellow with the American Strategy Program of the New America Foundation in the past, working on the Outsourcing National Security Initiative funded in part by the Ford Foundation. So please join me in welcoming Dr. Janine Wedel.
Excuse me. Thank you very much for the kind introduction. I'm delighted to be back here and to also welcome all of you and see many familiar faces. Let's begin with this. What do you think of when you hear the word corruption? A bribe? Virginia Governor McDonnell and his wife convicted of bribery and fraud? A jury found that they broke the law, but did they distort public policy in any meaningful way? Will their actions compromise our health, pocketbooks, or security, or lead to deep and lasting inequalities? When compared with practitioners of what I call the new corruption, the answer, I think, is no. In the new corruption, no envelope is passed under the table. No laws are clearly broken. Yet those who practice it violate our trust, and their actions reap consequences far more damaging than, say, McDonald's accepting an engraved Rolex. More and more, the modus operandi of these practitioners seems to be just the way business is done. And more, I'm seeing the same lack of accountability in our organizations and among top players that I saw as an anthropologist in Eastern Europe, both during and after communism. Unaccountability is a necessary, though not sufficient, condition of the new corruption. And so today I'd like to address these points. One, structured unaccountability. How is unaccountability structured into our organizations? Two, how has unaccountability become how has unaccountability become practically endemic among top power brokers? I guess the first slide disappeared. Sorry, that is supposed to have all four of them. Three, why do players not fall under the expert's definition of corruption? And four, what can we do about it? So let's turn to one, how is unaccountability structured into the organizations upon which we daily rely, corporate and government organizations? I began my journey to understanding structured unaccountability, not just through research and theory, but when it began to threaten my own finances. I learned that my otherwise stellar credit history, which I hoped would win me a favorable interest rate in refinancing my mortgage, had been wrecked by an overdue Bank of America credit card balance of which I was completely unaware. When I'd canceled, or I thought I canceled my credit card, my Bank of America told me that I had a zero balance. I had a cancellation number and the name of the person and the ID number of the person to prove it. I thought straightening things out would be easy. Thus began 20 plus hours on the phone with no fewer than 20 plus different individuals in different places. I proceeded from Derek and Dina in customer service in Southern California to John, a customer service supervisor to Philippe in the privacy source department, and while he wasn't authorized to say, to Carolyn in the credit department, a totally different phone number, to Adam in credit protection, Omaha, to Elsa in the credit department, or was it card services in Georgia, to Julia in external customer relations, to Delia in escalations department, the name of which alone tells you something, to Sophia also in escalations, and to Carol in credit analysis in Ohio. Back to customer services, Dan, and then Heather in card services, Kenton in credit analysis, Susan in online banking in South Carolina, and sandwiched in there somewhere, Jim, a manager in a call center. My journey transported me back to an unlikely place, communist Poland in the early 1980s under martial law. I recalled one afternoon when I spent 6 hours on the phone trying to place an international call. Was I now up against the same kind of behemoth? And did I mention that the charge that wreaked such havoc was a $13.69 bill, and that it was for a credit protection plan? That is, the package I bought to alert me to any problems had actually upended it. Exasperated, I tried to fix my problem the old-fashioned way, hoping to appeal face-to-face to a physically present person, look him in the eye, and establish a sense of trust, just as I would have in the old Poland. I walked into a local Bank of America branch. I was greeted by Charles. We were joined by Bob, who called in Ronald, the bank manager. All tried to help. But what could they do? Only get on the phone and call into that same phone tree. Through this puzzling maze, I saw firsthand how many organizations now immunize themselves from accountability, leaving anyone subject to their organization, in this case me, helpless. I couldn't help but wonder about the fates of so many other people who work 3 minimum wage jobs. Wouldn't they have just have given up in my situation? In the old world, it was easier, the old world several decades ago, it was easier to identify who was in charge. In the new world, the interactions of the digital age have disconnected the bureaucrat from the client in ways never before possible. And with the bulk of technological expertise and data in the hands of big government and corporations, the system can reach out and touch you, but you can't it. Bureaucracy is organized into silos and information universes with bits and bytes separated from each other, treading in a sea of digital routines. In the Bank of America example, Carol in Ohio in credit analysis had never heard of the bank that assigned me the bank unit that assigned me cancellation numbers and station numbers. Carol and others working in such silos are incentivized to have a stake only in their own little cubicles, not in the larger outcome for the client or the public. Carol is no doubt evaluated by how well she performs on this checklist before passing me, and can I help you with anything else today? Before passing me on to the next checklist and the next silo. She's not the only siloized bureaucrat ruled by a checklist. Think banking in the run-up to the 2008 financial crisis. The banker repackaging mortgages and selling them is focused on clicking off the number of deals, his eyes on a bonus, with little stake in the eventual outcome of the deal, even for his client, let alone society. Sociologists and anthropologists of finance have argued that this kind of siloization and splintering of information facilitated the financial meltdown. In fact, it was sociologists who coined the term structured unaccountability to describe how banks trading in exotic derivatives were organized. Exotic derivatives, by the way, signal a crisis of truth that runs deep. In the old world, banks knew much more than today about what holdings they had, and traders knew more about the value of what they were trading. Recall the expression, Let's listen to what the market says. Markets were said to function as harbingers of truth and barometers of the state of the world. But today, prices are much more disconnected from reality. The value of complex derivatives is often unclear. Madame Beauregard might be able to tell you with a crystal ball, might be able to tell you what's in your derivative. In the financial collapse, people saw their investments sink, not quite aware that bankers were slicing and dicing mortgages into financial Frankensteins. Just months after my odyssey with Bank of America, its CEO faced protests for years of shoddy lending and bad service as people struggled to refinance their mortgages. His response, "You can call us and we'll figure it out." He urged people to try the toll-free number. Accountability has been structured out of the system to such a degree that even the CEO can claim quite conveniently that he is as helpless as the rest of us. Deniability is the great new perk of power. Hear nothing, see nothing, speak nothing. Welcome to the new world of 21st century corruption, where the buck stops nowhere. This corruption centers on unaccountability, structured unaccountability, and it's pervasive. Which is not at all to say that Carol in Ohio and others working in these organizations are themselves corrupt. So, two, how is it that today's top players have become so unaccountable? Players today have a multiplicity of affiliations and motives. Our culture has changed so fast and furiously over the past several decades that most people don't even pause to think about the affiliations they take on. In the old world, it would have been unthinkable for former leaders of the free world to use the prestige of their former office to create a highly lucrative and influential brand. Emphasis on the word brand. But in the new world, Tony Blair created what's been dubbed Blair Inc., which the Telegraph describes as a confusing mix of business, politics, and philanthropy that's administered by a complex system of companies. Blair has advised Wall Street bankers, European insurers, the government of Kazakhstan, among others, and even the late Gaddafi of Libya. While counseling Gaddafi, apparently on deals that J.P. Morgan wanted, he also served as an advisor to J.P. Morgan, and additionally as an official peace envoy to the Middle East. Also in the New World, Bill Clinton, after leaving office, in addition to creating the Clinton Foundation and its global initiative, has served as a paid advisor to the global private equity and consulting firm, among many other ventures. His close aide recruited philanthropic donors to be clients, and as the New York Times put it, some Clinton aides and foundation employees began to wonder where the foundation ended and the business began. And think of the potential boundary issues represented by that band of gold. What seems to be new is that Clinton and Blair are merging business, philanthropy, and policy, and the boundaries are either not there or they shift conveniently. That's what seems to be new. One finding that emerges from my work: today's top power brokers are agile and highly flexible and operate informally. They often use think tanks, other than this one, of course, and university affiliations, other than my own, of course, not true, as vehicles of influence. They often use them as vehicles of influence. Some even set up top-down grassroots, so-called grassroots organizations or nonprofits. These organizations help them launder their images and give them the veneer of impartiality. All this signals a seismic change over the past several decades wrought by privatization, the dispersion of global authority with the end of the Cold War, and digital technology. The rise of a new type of flexible power broker, and the move of power and influence underground is a signature feature of our era. Here's a power broker with multiple roles, symbolized by multiple cards. Professor, think tanker, public policymaker, CEO, media pundit, member of advisory board, you name it. He casts his influence net far and wide. This aids in deniability. So if questioned in his role as X, he can always say, I was operating in my role as Y. Such players can float above and across organizations and silos. Of course, what these players do is not necessarily unethical, but there's an information problem. We, the public, can't know what they're up to. They're unaccountable by conventional means. And that's why, despite the accountability systems in place, we all have them at the workplace and everywhere, and today's emphasis on transparency, true accountability seems in short supply, whether we're talking about corporate and government organizations or major leaders and influencers. These players operate in arenas from healthcare and homeland security to finance and foreign policy. Take, for instance, so-called key opinion leaders, or KOLs. KOLs are high-status physicians or medical researchers who are paid or perked by pharmaceutical or medical device companies to convince their fellow professionals, their fellow doctors, to convince them that a particular company's product is the most efficacious. But KOLs don't disclose their sponsorship, hence the information problem. According to a Queen's University study, KOLs, by certain measures, have tripled in the past decade plus. Or consider the activities of 19 highly regarded academic economists who promoted specific financial reform proposals and gave expert advice to government bodies and the media in the run-up to and just after the 2008 financial crisis. A University of Mass Amherst study found that the vast majority of the time, the economists did not identify their private affiliations and possible conflicts of interest when, for instance, they were testifying before congressional agencies, or congressional bodies. All these experts define the terms of the debate, and they act as gatekeepers for the debate. We, the public, are led to believe that they're playing on our team, and they may be, but they may not be. While appearing as impartial authorities, they can champion a particular policy or product without divulging that it benefits the industry or the company for which they consult. Is this not a violation of our trust? Consider, too, retired generals and admirals. My Mapping Shadow Influence project has been given privileged access to two databases, one in the military arena, the other in finance, that illustrate these power brokers in action and how unaccountability has grown. The data I'll show you now is of retired generals and admirals. A groundbreaking study by the Boston Globe in 2010 amassed a database of nearly 800 retired senior military officers, which my project has added to, and looked at the post-retirement careers of these former public servants. It used to be that they retired to play golf or with their grandkids. But over the past several decades, they've gone mostly from retirement when they retired to mostly continued service. These senior officers typically retire at a relatively young age, and they live longer than in the past. They've been thoroughly schooled in the military code of ethics and no doubt believe that they can police themselves. That's the standard explanation, whether we're talking about the KOLs or the academic economists or the retired generals. And while it may be perfectly reasonable that they continue working, and we shouldn't imply that their only motivation is money, should we, the public, simply look the other way? Some of them pursue a multi-pronged strategy that affords them money and influence. This image shows a network of corporations, government entities, and nonprofits that are connected through senior retired officers, okay? As the Boston Globes and other investigations have found, some retired officers are paid advisors in military agencies, while at the same time, consultants to defense and intelligence contractors. others sit on government advisory boards and can parlay that information and access from the inside to their consultancies with contractors. This long-term trend has been accelerating. So this is 1992. Each slide represents that I'm going to show you represents a change of 2 years. The circles and dots on here are individuals. The lines between circles represent business relationships between individuals. Like these two might sit on say the defense policy board or the defense business board together, or they might work together in the same defense contractor. So let me show you what happened over 20-year period, how this looks over 20-year period. So these images show how many of the senior retired officers followed each other into the same firm, started consultancy or venture capital companies together, or served on the same boards. Reflecting on this trend, Senator Jack Reed, a West Point graduate, said this: "When I was an officer in the 1970s, most general officers went off to some sunny place and retired. Now, the definition of success is to move on and become successful in the business world. Even in the military, where devotion to the institution is paramount, there's been a shift from institution to self. What does this mean for accountability? The process of vetting defense projects should serve the public interest. Let's take, for instance, the Senior Mentors Program set up by the Pentagon, in which retired officers were enlisted to advise their former colleagues in defense agencies. Note the innocuous civic-sounding name, Senior Mentors Program. Whenever you run across such a name, your Geiger counter should go way up. USA Today found that 80% of the senior mentors were also working in some capacity for defense contractors, advising military services, even as they were consulting for companies seeking to sell military products, even when they might also have financial ties to the companies peddling the services. In these and other arenas, many most likely haven't considered the unaccountability inherent in the overlapping roles they craft for themselves. They're mostly not bad apples, but their patterns of activity leave us, the public, without crucial information, without an easy way to untangle their roles. How can we know whether more concerned about their company's financial interests or those of the taxpayers or the nation? We can't know. And we used to have more help from journalism, which has been decimated in recent years. We have to rely on the few investigative reporters left standing to unearth some of this. And I have a whole chapter in my book about how about journalism, the demise of investigative reporting and the implications for unaccountability. I started off by talking about online pornography and trends in online pornography. So you'll certainly want to take a look. Two are not unrelated. So then there are players I call shadow lobbyists. Linda Keenan and I coined this term in the Huffington Post a few years ago. Shadow lobbyists choose not to register as lobbyists when they're quite obviously wielding influence that we can't see or trace. So prevalent have their activities become that shadow lobbyists may actually be overtaking registered lobbyists. The number of registered lobbyists peaked in 2007 at nearly 15,000 and fell to a little over 11,000 in 2014, just 7 years later, according to the Center for Responsive Politics. The business of influencing has changed so much in a few short years that the American League of Lobbyists decided late last year to adopt the more innocuous Association of Government Relations Professionals. As the president of the organization said in a letter to members, we discovered that a vast majority of our membership no longer identified themselves as only lobbyists. Shadow lobbyists are often former high government officials, now with consulting or law firms, often in, by the way, the public sector or the government affairs group. They take on abstruse roles of influence within the corporate world. Many appear in the media as disinterested experts, nearly always identified with their former public service title, even if they get paid huge sums in the service of an unrevealed client. Joining the legions of shadow lobbyists, too, are A-list firms that take business from unsavory regimes to burnish their images, activity that not very long ago might have been considered treasonous. One firm employs, quote, all sorts of dark arts, their words, on the internet, editing Wikipedia entries deemed damaging to their clients, setting up third-party blogs that appear to be independent, but of course aren't, gaming search results to ensure that positive content outweighs the negative. Such efforts sway public perception and they mold policy, yet are virtually invisible, even to a trained observer. Prominent academics are also susceptible to being enlisted as shadow lobbyists. Before Arab Spring, Libya's outlaw image began improving, in all probability because it hired the Monitor Group, powered by Harvard and Washington power brokers, for $250,000 a month to engage in a stealth propaganda campaign. Again, the players in the companies and organizations that sponsor them fail to reveal their real agendas and networks, while we, the public, have no easy way of knowing what they are up to. And perhaps this is why people from Turkey and Greece to India, Brazil, Ukraine, and even the United States are sensing that something is amiss. But not surprisingly, have difficulty in identifying just who is responsible, just like I did in the Bank of America case. Perhaps this is why people are rapidly losing faith in their country's institutions and leaders. Public opinion polls the world over show a striking loss of confidence in formal institutions, from governments, parliaments, and courts, to banks and corporations, to the media. Of course, straightforward corruption like bribery is still common and causes outcry in countries across the globe. But the new unaccountability is leading to grassroots ire in many of these same countries. Classic and I think more relevant notions of corruption as the violation of public trust appear to be closer to the hearts of many, many protesters and at the hearts of today's most damaging, of some of, much of today's most damaging corruption. But while regular people everywhere have been noticing this new style, pervasive unaccountability, and beginning to call out corruption, many of the corruption experts have not. And this brings me to point three. Why do these players not fall under the experts' definition of corruption? Corruption as the abuse of public office for private gain, which is often taken as a synonym for bribery. Clues can be found in the evolution of the post-Cold War anti-corruption industry, which I saw up close in the 1990s as an anthropologist in Eastern Europe and as an occasional consultant to the World Bank. That industry developed under the influence of economists whose models and metrics often led to missing the bigger and perhaps more important picture. A 1999 Washington Conference on Corruption, organized by an array of U.S. and international entities, embodies the zeitgeist of the industry. The venue, this Washington upscale hotel. A keynote speaker at the opening session, the Honorable Robert Rubin, Secretary of the U.S. Treasury and past co-chairman of Goldman Sachs. Just a week earlier, he and his deputy secretary, Larry Summers, along with Federal Reserve Chair Alan Greenspan, were mugging triumphantly on the cover of Time magazine, hailed as the Committee to Save the World. At the conference, Rubin lent his heft to one Saving the World project, anti-corruption in developing countries and emerging economies. The lineup, with stars like Rubin, also included the world's top business lobbies and heavyweights from the UN and the OECD. Transparency International, a non-governmental organization, and the World Bank were pioneering efforts to combat corruption. Transparency's corporate sponsors in this era included AIG, Arthur Andersen, Bank of America, Enron, Lockheed Martin, and Pfizer. And who wouldn't want to join the party? The U.S. economy was roaring at full blast despite some market tremors overseas. Wall Street was going like gangbusters, and the conventional wisdom was that they could best police themselves, like the players we just discussed. In this heady atmosphere, the conference participants and their brethren in the business and investment community could crack the problem of corruption in Africa, Latin America, Asia, and the former Soviet Union Eastern Bloc, do good, and make countries out there more hospitable to investment. The new corruption, potentially much more harmful to the United States and the West, did not even enter their thinking, even though Washington insiderism and Wall Street malfeasance were already thriving, only to reach their calamitous peak in 2008. Players were engaging in what one Polish sociologist called dirty togetherness, the informal exchange system that pushed the envelope of propriety, but that nearly everyone under communism participated in. Indeed, while some of the world's most publicly engaged economists were the brains behind the anti-corruption industry, other economists were serving as handmaidens for investment banks and credit rating agencies, as these institutions engaged in some of the boldest violations of the public trust in history. Several unspoken tenets of the anti-corruption industry are palpable. One is privatization. They believed in privatizing as a cure-all for corruption. We all know how well that worked out in Russia and Eastern Europe. Another is metrics. Economists at the World Bank and at Transparency had devised metrics to make sense of corruption in terms of a single number or score. By the time of the conference, Transparency, one of the conference partners' organizations, was in its fifth year of publicizing its Corruption Perceptions Index. That annual list measures corruption in countries around the world as perceived by experts and business leaders, and it was focusing public attention on corruption. A single score, the storylines imply, conveys the corruption of an entire country. Ordering countries by rank shows us how one country compares to another. In 1999, a typical year, Scandinavian and West European countries ranked the highest, meaning the most clean, with the United States not far behind. Economies like Indonesia, Nigeria, and Cameroon were at or close to the bottom. It's easy to see the appeal of corruption merely as bribery and of ranking systems. Single numbers released each year are easy to grasp, seductive in their clarity, and media friendly. But does this make sense as public policy? The mid or low level Nigerian or Ukrainian bureaucrat earning many times less than his Western counterpart is disparaged for taking bribes that feed his family. Meanwhile, prestige cloaked practitioners of the new corruption, whose undisclosed roles and influence help shape policy, get a pass. My point is not that the corruption targets of the economists and the anti-corruption industry don't deserve our attention. They do. Old-style corruption is a huge problem for those who face it. But the anti-corruption industry in its heyday was focused so narrowly that by definition, the new corruption and the massive unaccountability inherent in it was nearly excluded. However unaware of their blinders and however well-intentioned many of the anti-corruption economists and their acolytes may have been, their contracted view of corruption offered the perfect intellectual cover and enabled them to ignore the new corruption right under their noses. We too eat up, and the media focus on, images of traditional corruption and its prosecution. These are headlines, separate stories from the Washington Post, very well done stories. The Washington Post is one of the world's most esteemed papers. This dazzle can distract us from seeing the new corruption. But ordinary people still sense something is awry. Opinion polls, as we said, show that Americans' trust in leaders and institutions has plummeted. This recalls Eastern Europe during late communism, where I witnessed a pervasive feeling of helplessness, fatalism, and gallows humor. Now I'm seeing similar responses here in the supposedly much more transparent West. Another parallel worth noting quickly between the United States today and Soviet Union under late communism is the mainstream media, particularly TV. A couple of scholars who've studied this in depth note the formulaic quality of messaging in the media, that is the predictable and repetitive narratives that we see from channel to channel. This is a parallel between the United States today and late communism. Even with our seemingly infinite choices of media outlets. So, what can we do about it? We need to understand that the most damaging corruption today in the United States is organized differently than the bribe-taking Nigerian official. If we're to deal with it, we must incorporate that understanding into policy and culture. We have to follow the players, not just the money. Remember that the players don't operate in just one sphere or another, in just the government or the private sector. They specialize. Indeed, their strength is blending and blurring the state and the private sectors. It's not a quid pro quo. It's not a quid pro quo. A lot of what the players are doing is building their portfolio for exploitation later. We have to go back to basics. To track the influence, for instance, of the retired generals, we need to chart their roles, activities, networks, organizations, and sponsors, and to look at how these building blocks interact. We need to cross-reference their positions and the bases they cover, connect the dots. We also need to rethink the approach to accountability. The approach to accountability has failed us in the same way that the siloized structure of Bank of America failed me. It suffers from the same problem of the silos of structured unaccountability. True accountability can't be reduced to checklist systems and metrics. It can't be a mere performance for the external auditor, whether that auditor is our donors or whether it's our boss. True accountability can't be simply imposed from the outside, severed from its original spirit and from larger institutional knowledge. Not sure what happened to my slides. Whoops. Slides have disappeared. Well, what about tougher regulation? I'd love to be able to suggest, like the progressive reformers, a host of legislative fixes, but the book has a number of examples of players who have gone informal and private precisely in response to new laws and regulation. We need to understand the regulatory process as a fluid situation that doesn't end with the president's signature. Dodd-Frank would be an excellent example of how lobbyists have obfuscated the implementation. We need to be hypervigilant in looking for, indeed anticipating the consequences of regulation. Witness the 2007 regulation on lobbying that sent many lobbyists underground. In conclusion, I want to emphasize public trust. If we ourselves are a multiple role player with overlapping roles, we might subject them to a smell test. What would the plumber or the mailman say? We might start a discussion within our own community or circle or profession about our own activities and how we're perceived by others. At the very least, we can be transparent about our roles. Today's most damaging corruption is the violation of public trust. It needs to be restored. And if you'd like to see my FICO scores, see me afterwards. Thank you.
Can I sit on over here?
Yep.
Well, thank you, Janine. So what you're talking about as corruption is not anything illegal.
Right.
It's what has been called influence peddling or lobbying, although we learn from you now this is going to be government professional relations or something like this.
Right.
In the future. Well, listening to your talk, I'm sort of in the middle of this, having been in the nonprofit sector, journalism, and even the academy over the years. And I think one of the real problems we face is the increasing funding by interested sources of experts. So that you get the retired general who's working for a defense contractor, but they don't tell you this, right? Or the healthcare expert who's most of whose income comes from the pharmaceutical industry, which is fine if they identified it, but there's no way that the reader or the television watcher will ever know this. And this has changed in the last 30 years that I've been around in Washington. And I think the single factor that has led to the greatest change is the slashing of payment to three groups of individuals, journalists, academics, and nonprofit sector people. Back in the 1980s and the 1990s, there were fewer of these jobs. But if you got a job at the Washington Post or the New York Times or whatever, you were actually paid a living salary. Mm-hmm. It was very difficult. There were far fewer think tanks than there are today. But if you were one of the lucky few to get to be a think tank fellow, you had a professorial income, and you didn't need to do consulting on the side if you were satisfied with that. And the same thing with professors. Some of you may know that a majority of students now in the United States are not taught by tenured professors. They are taught by lecturers, often graduate students, who are paid on average something, what is it, like $15,000 a year. It's essentially the minimum wage. That's the majority of undergraduate college students.
In research universities, this is the case. It's not just the community college.
And the other day, I met a research professor from a university, and I said, "Well, you're really lucky to have a tenured position nowadays. There are fewer and fewer." Turns out, it's just a title. This individual raises all of his own money every single year.
Yeah.
So he said, "You could be a research professor too. You just go to this university, and say, I'll raise my own income from whatever source, you know." Industry, foundations, whatever, I'll pay you, the university, so essentially it's buying titles, right? I don't know how, in the case of journalism, there's clearly a reason why this took place. It was Craigslist and eBay killed off journalism, because what funded journalism from the 18th century up to the 21st were the ads in the back. And because you had these monopoly rents, if you wanted to get a used lawnmower in the D.C. area, you had to go to the Washington Post, the Washington Star, in the old days, whatever. So therefore, you could fund Woodward and Bernstein, and they would do all this investigating report. Once you have Craigslist and eBay, boom, that's gone. So then you essentially get the rolling bankruptcy of these media corporates. So I understand there's a technological, economic reason for why you don't pay reporters anymore. What I don't understand is, there's more philanthropic money than there has ever been sloshing around with Silicon Valley and Wall Street and all of that. If they wanted to, every single professor in the U.S. could be paid a six-figure salary. You could endow think tanks with where you're not.
Right.
And just to wrap up, I don't want to go on too far. Once you are not paying people a living wage, you're just paying them a partial stipend to be experts. And then you say, well, we expect you to raise your own money on the outside. Well, where's the money? The money is with the lobbies and the trade associations, right? I mean, there's just not that much nonprofit pure money out there. But see, the other insidious thing is, if you have institutions, whether they're universities which sell professorships, mm-hmm. or think tanks which sell fellowships, and there are some that do this, we don't. But there are some where essentially they will make you a fellow. You just, pay in whatever the fee is, and they'll give you the title. That means that suddenly you're multiplying. There's an ever-grading number of these experts, most of whom are actually subsidized by interested groups. And there's no way the general public can tell who's actually deriving their income from the university or the think tank, and who just has this title but is actually working for a pharmaceutical company or defense contractor or something like that. So that's just my...
Exactly. So this, again, the issue is the information problem. We, the public, what these players are, what these people are doing is not necessarily unethical. It's certainly not illegal, but everybody is under tremendous pressure. Practically every profession, every sphere, whether it's medicine or academia, you name it. And so where are people getting their money? People have to support their families. So they get it from where the money is available. And philanthropy is actually is a very interesting thing to watch, because for several reasons. Of course, philanthropists are giving the money where they're giving it very often because they have their own agenda. So journalism funded by philanthropists may be a wonderful thing, and there are many nonprofit entities that are funded now that do investigative reporting and that are trying to take over where the traditional media is left off. But we always have to look at who are their funders, what might be their agendas, what might be their biases. It's an information problem.
Pat Malloy at the back.
Justice. I was 15 years on the staff of the Senate Banking Committee. I worked for Bill Proxmire, who wrote the Foreign Corrupt Practices Act. I was then a political appointee in the Clinton administration. I was 10 years on the U.S.-China Commission. China Commission, a bipartisan group, a think tank for Congress, paid for by the public for thinking about China and our economic and trade policies and how it impacts American national security. But here are two things I've seen through the years. One, when you're in government now, but the money is outside of government, it affects the people and how they behave in government. Because if you're going to want to get the job outside of government, you got to play ball.
Yeah.
So that's one, so it really corrupts the whole government system. You understand? And that's what these generals,
even these
generals are going to look further. They won't hire any general. Right. They hire the generals that are favorable to their point of views. So that's one thing. Let me make one more point. Mm-hmm. Ken Lieberthal, who was on the national security staff under Clinton, is now at Brookings. He wrote a book about China-U.S. relations. And he said this in his book. When a Chinese government sees legislation developing in our Congress, like to deal with the exchange rate manipulation, they will encourage U.S. multinational corporations to lobby against that legislation. So other countries are now playing on this corruption in our system, and these companies that we think are American companies are lobbying on behalf of foreign interest. We got a real terrific problem, and I'm so glad that you're writing about this now, because I've seen it very well from a lot of different places in the government.
Thank you. Can just respond to that. So I think the first point is very interesting and important, that I think that what you're describing is that the profile of today's top power broker has changed. So today, the top government job is very often just one rung on the ladder to making a lot of money,
yes,
and to the ultimate success. So public service doesn't seem to be a value in its own right in the way that it used to be. And getting the, you know, Secretary of the Treasury or what have you is just one rung that you need to achieve the ultimate goal.
Well, I would
yeah,
put it differently.
Yeah.
Being a member of Congress is a great internship for K Street.
Yeah.
Another thing I was wondering about was when George Marshall, former, who supervised the U.S. victory in World War II, Secretary of State under Truman, when he retired from government service, he was offered $1 million, which would be much larger in inflation-adjusted terms now for his memoirs, and he refused because it would be dishonorable. Has something happened to Western society? You've studied Eastern Europe and so on. There used to be the professions, the military, the law, medicine, they used to be held in great prestige, and so you had two status hierarchies. There's money, but there's also the professions. And so the people in money always business always made vastly more money than the people in the professions. But you could be a respectable former general or former civil servant or something, and this was an honorable thing, mm-hmm, right? And it seems now that moral system is collapsing, mm-hmm, you know, the professors, lawyers, soldiers. And essentially the moral system that is universal is what was one part of the system. It's now the whole system. It's essentially private business where you're judged by purely how rich you are, how much money you make.
Right, and celebrityhood.
Well, that may be another.
Is another element of this. So celebrityhood seems to have replaced, in some sense, prestige. So in combination with the money, but it's been a huge cultural shift just over the past 20, 30 years that it has happened so quickly that I think most of us, I mean, we see it around us, happening around us, but it's very difficult to really put it together and figure out what's happening. And that's really why I wrote the book, because I'm trying to get across that these are patterns, that it isn't just some happening over here or over here or over here. It's happening across the board, and we need to understand it as a systemic issue that we need to deal with head on.
Yes, front row.
Yeah.
What's KOL? What's KOL? And secondly, I think I heard you say that this behavior, like I go to a doctor and he recommends a particular course of action or surgery or whatever, and I'm not aware that he has interest in some, and I think I heard you say that's not unethical. And to me, that is unethical.
Okay. Yeah, so let me explain. So the KOLs are the key opinion leaders who are paid or perked by pharmaceutical companies or medical device companies, and they're not usually at a big teaching, high prestige hospital that you might actually encounter them, but the real problem, the real issue there is that these are high status people who are often on medical journals, editors of medical journals. They're at the most prestigious medical universities, teaching universities, and they're being paid essentially to sway the opinion of other physicians. So no, you go to your doctor, and he or she is prescribing you a course of action in good faith. What he or she doesn't necessarily get is that so-and-so high status person is who's recommending this course of treatment and who's really the gatekeeper, acting as a gatekeeper for the discussion. This is very insidious and subtle.
Would it be unethical if I don't know about this connection with other...
Yeah, but your doctor, your direct doctor doesn't know, may not know either. Is my point, yes. And I think that is,
I don't mean to, but doctor I see for prostate, he told me, I think this medicine might work for you or help you,
right,
but I need to tell you that I'm on the board of that, but I also take that medication myself. He said, it's your choice what you do.
But he actually told you.
That was to me ethical.
Yeah.
I'm saying, if you don't tell me, that is unethical.
Yeah, yeah. Yeah, no, I would agree. But just to clarify that the KOLs are, not, I mean, they're the, and so your physicians don't necessarily know, because they're reading all, the, like we all are reading these things. We don't know where it comes from necessarily. We just know that high status person X said it, and then there's other information out there. If they're the gatekeepers for the discussion.
Yeah, hi. Most of the people you mentioned, the Tony Blair, Bill Clinton, could be considered people on the make, not those who've made it. I don't think any of anyone you mentioned would be included in the top 100 richest people in America, or probably even the top 500 richest. To what extent should we look at these people as power brokers versus apparatchiks for the real power brokers?
Well, I mentioned you know, Blair and Clinton just as a way of showing that the you know, the trend has changed. They were not my real, you
well,
know, but
they
but
be
so
on the cover of the Time magazine.
Right. So when Ford let's stick with this for a second. So when President Ford retired as president, he went to be on boards of companies. When President Carter retired, he began to got involved in all kinds of philanthropic activities. What's new, what seems to be new, is the blending of philanthropy. And indeed, philanthropy has to be one of the things that you do, or not has to be, but almost very often is something that you do if you're a top power broker. You have this consultancy and that consultancy, and then you also have a philanthropic role. So the what I'm trying to say is that all these spheres, the profile has changed. So when the people that I talked about more in the talk were people in the different professions, the KOLs, for instance, the academic economists, the military generals and admirals. And there we can see, too, just in the past several decades, that things have changed quite dramatically.
A couple in the back.
I apologize, I came in late because of Acela, and you may have gone through this already, but it offends me a lot more when people bend the government than when they get rich off it. I mean, I think the real issue is how they influence policy.
Bend the government.
When people bend,
It's not, I don't care if Clinton gets rich. I care if somebody pays off a congressperson to do something that will favor people's companies.
That's not what she's after. And I think it's a very important point she's after, that it's not just quid pro quo bribes. It's the way it influences even your behavior when you're in office and carrying out the public interest. If you want to make money, you got to play the ball game to be able to position yourself to be able to be acceptable to the moneyed people outside when you leave them.
Well, if I can weigh into this emerging free-for-all, I think it's a mistake looking at where you worked before you went into government. It's your future employers. So you may never, ever have been through the revolving door before, but if you're thinking, you know, that you're going to go in the defense industry, if you're a military officer, if you're going to go into finance, if you're at a, you know, in Treasury, something like that, then even if you have no record whatsoever of, so that's why, we'll see what Dr. Wedel thinks, but that's why I think it does make a difference what happens to politicians and civil servants after they leave. Because if that becomes the normal career path, then they're all thinking, you know, this is my tryout, you know, for Wall Street or, you know, whatever.
Right.
Yeah.
So yeah, well, so yes, yeah, so what we have to look at is how people are building. Very often they're building their portfolio. So the retired general who's on CNN, he may or may not be, I mean, the most egregious would be if he's advocating the course of action that is being promoted by his company or a product that his company's producing, that sort of thing, and where he's just, of course, identified only as a retired general. But just getting on CNN and becoming known, what does that do for him? Well, that means that people are going to take his calls if he's known, right? So it's part of building the, what he's doing is not unethical, just appearing on CNN and providing his expertise. But that's part of building the portfolio. And that's why this whole state of affairs is so insidious.
Two gentlemen in blue shirts, one after the other.
My question relates a little bit to the other gentleman's question. You call these people power brokers, but I consider them just the mercenaries. As the book back in the 60s, the super rich, don't look at the mercenaries. Look at the people who have the money. Now, a couple of days ago, I looked at the top 400 richest people in America, and most of them were total unknowns to me. I don't know who are the most egregious of the rich in trying to influence the government, not their henchmen.
Although I agree with your description of what the situation is today, I'm a little confused about how you see it came about, because it seems to me that there was a brief period of time where you had countervailing powers and people like professors actually had influence on public policy and everything. And when business realized that they weren't dominating anymore the economy and what was going on, they made a very concerted effort and spent a great amount of resources over 30, 40 years now to dominate all these other institutions like academics and think tanks and professions. And now the neoliberal ideology totally dominates this country. If you talk to young people, they don't really think there's any alternative. And a lot of what you've described is, to me, is like the end result of what's happened over 30 years. And I don't think that information in itself would change anything. I mean, more and more people I know realize what's going on, but they don't think that there's anything else to do except play the game.
Want to take a few more questions?
Sure.
Thank you, Janine, for a very interesting and fun and enjoyable and informative presentation. But I wanted to echo this gentleman here and what was just said back there. Ultimately, a broker is just a broker, right? There are people beyond and above and more significant than those brokers for organizing power and society. Congress has only been mentioned as a path to wealth rather than the corrupt institution it has become in terms of failing to pass appropriate regulatory. Nobody has mentioned the Supreme Court and Citizens United, which has just unleashed the flow of money in this society to facilitate, to enable the folks that you talk about. One last theoretical question. So how does then this differ, besides scale and intensity and the ability of these lower level, somebody called them mercenaries, we can call them willing servants of the Koch brothers and the like. How does the scale, besides scale and intensity and degree of connectedness, how does your thesis differ from C. Wright Mills? 1950s, right? What's new and unique?
Okay. Well, I wish I had my slides back on because I could show you. So C. Wright Mills had the three pillars of power. He had the military industry, he had he had government, and he had business, right? He had three pillars of power. So what we have today, and here's where the brokers come in, and these brokers, by the way, many of them are very rich, whether we've heard of them or not, as was pointed out. The brokers are influential in policy, even if they don't wield direct power. So what you would see, if I had my other slides up, is you would see the power broker in the center. So instead of the three pillars of power, you'd see the power broker in the center, and around him are the think tank and the defense industry and the government consultancy, and it's him who's connecting all these dots. And therein lies his influence, not direct power, but his influence, the ability to work the system. So, for example, we found when we're looking at the retired generals, we were looking at some specific policy decisions that were made that were made precisely because there was a confluence of these retired senior officers. I think we can show who were working the multiplicity of these different places. So the profile of how power and influence has worked works has changed, and it's changed dramatically. And the reason has to do with there are four overarching transformational developments that have led to this. One has to do with the privatizing and the outsourcing of government, which started gained great impetus in the 1980s in the United States and the United Kingdom, and then was spread around the world. Another is the end of the Cold War that opened up many new spheres for private individuals to play public roles, the proliferation of consultants and experts and so on. And then you get the digital age. I mean, this is what is undeniable is the role of the digital age in all of this. And social media. Social media is only 10 years old. And look at how it is absolutely upended the media and how power brokers are having to respond to it.
Well, I would push back to you a little bit on I think your old world was a bit idealized. I think the U.S. has always been corrupt, just incredibly corrupt, like most countries. Oh. The big difference in the last half century has been the historic American pattern was it was extremely regional and local. So Harry Truman was a product of the Pendergast machine, this kind of mafia in Kansas City. You know, Lyndon Johnson comes out of Brown and Root and the Parr brothers in South Texas and all of that, and all of the politicians. But generally, it was either at the state level or at the local level. So there were these rich interests. The rich family owns the big city newspaper, and even back then, you know, they had all this power. If you were an investigative reporter in Chicago in the 1920s, and you ran abreast of the interests, you know, that story never appeared back then. But the difference was there was a kind of pluralism, right? Because it wasn't just the same few billionaires didn't control everything. You had lots of rich, crooked local millionaires instead of a few very powerful people that everybody's going to for money.
And they were easier to see.
Yeah, and they were everybody knew.
Colonel McCormick, right?
He was the guy who was the big player and publisher in Chicago and in much of the 20th century. So, you know, what really illustrated this for me was a retired senator told me, who'd been a senator in the 70s and 80s and 90s, that now, whatever your party is, the DNC or the RNC, they give you a list of the rich people, and they're mostly in a couple of cities. It's mostly in New York and Palo Alto. And so no matter what your state is, right, as a senator or congressman, you just go to these rich people in California and New York, right? And maybe, I don't know, in some cases it might be Houston, if it's energy industry. And that is a new development in American history, because in the old days, if you were from Illinois, you represented the corrupt interests of Illinois to the best of your ability. Now we seem to be moving to this system where everyone is getting money from the same Wall Street people and the same tech billionaires.
Yeah, the role of locality has been diminished, the role of place. Yeah.
Up front row here?
Oh, yeah.
I just wanted to go back to your original problem with Bank of America and credit cards, because you called in the hope or in the belief that you would be able most efficiently to pursue that course and straighten it out. But you have to wonder about what kind of structure, how many people, whose incentive was it to have a structure that you had to spend or that they had to spend that much time working on your problem? And it also makes me wonder how many people like you don't get it squared. I mean, you had the same wonder. I just don't get how that could be cost effective. And I mean, you wonder if there's accountability on the phone versus if you'd sat down and written a letter, but you don't have any promise that you'll ever get a return letter.
Well, who do you write the letter to?
Exactly. But something's got to improve on that.
It's cost effective if people give up.
Absolutely.
Well, that's what I'm
yeah.
saying.
Right. Yeah. I mean, I think there's a lot of work to be done on bureaucracy and trying to understand how this bureaucracy works in the digital age, because it's very different from Weberian bureaucracy, which of course Weber's bureaucracy, which was an ideal type. But I mean, if you even think of the, you know, big bad communist bureaucracy, to give a bit of a stereotype, but the behemoth bureaucracy, at least I could go and I could find somebody to bribe, right? It was an efficient system, right? But I even tried at one point on the phone, just as a kind of experiment, I said, you know, I'm really desperate. I'd be happy to send you $800. And, you know, of course, it's all being recorded for, you know, but I mean, it was kind of the only way I got it resolved was because I said to somebody finally, who was probably a middle-aged person like myself, I said, you know, this is just like living under communism, except there, I could eventually.
I had this runaround when I ordered a TV set.
Yeah.
And then the store just gave me the endless loop. So I just got so angry. I seldom do this. So I looked up the company that sold it online.
Yeah.
And it turned out that in the Midwest, in a mm-hmm. medium-sized city right. in the Midwest, I think it's Minneapolis or something, they had the headquarters. Mm-hmm. So I went there. I got the executive secretary of the CEO. Somehow I directly got mm-hmm. through and explained my problem. And within 15 minutes, the problem was solved.
Yeah. Yeah,
but few people are going to
right.
Go
I mean,
to those
it's
links.
Only through those sort of quirky, not linear processes that you can, you know, that you're able to solve these sort of difficult problems. So there's a lot to be done to understand how bureaucracy is now working in the digital. This is not an American story. This is a fairly universal story, and everybody has a story. So what I mean the upshot is that the customer has much less power to actually intervene and make a difference than we used to because of this massive bureaucracy. So, I mean, a lot of other elements to it, not just the siloization, but there's been so much of it gets outsourced. And again, you have the ambiguity between who's in the system and who isn't, who's working for the company, who isn't. So that's another issue that has been alluded to already.
Hi, thank you very much. It's a wonderful presentation. I have a question on your, let's say, ideal type, because it seems you're describing two different, or at least two different moments within the same phenomenon. The first one has to do with the siloing, right, and the lack of connections. But then when you're describing the power brokers, right, they are the glue across right. the silos.
Exactly. So exactly. So you got it. So how can these two things exist in the same world? We're on the one hand, we have this, you know, super siloized, you know, where nobody can, you know, where nobody can intervene. Well, on the other hand, that creates the need. I mean, this is only one, you know, one reason that you need these people. There are all these other developments that I talked about. But yeah, that creates the need for people who can move across the silos, who can move across these organizations, who are in them but they're not of them. Right? So that's exactly right.
I'd like to go back to General Marshall and what he did, and when he did it. And I would like to ask the question, clearly what he did was a moral thing to do, at least from his morality standpoint. Have we entered over the years a different morality? Is this really the basic problem that we're looking at?
Well, morality doesn't exist in And ethics don't exist separate from society and culture. And culture doesn't lie, it's been said. So there's an inner relationship, of course, between all these developments which have happened so quickly, the end of the Cold War, the advent of the digital age, social media. We can't keep up with it. We can't even keep up with what we ourselves are doing. So I think we haven't really had the time to think about this. And what is needed is a discussion, societal discussion. What's happening here?
One more question, right here.
I just want to dovetail on a few things that were said. So Janine, what seemed to be emerging is that in the new bureaucracy, there are people who work in silos. In a new bureaucracy, there are people who work in silos. And when you deal with these people themselves are pretty powerless. Because, you know, you judge on your matrix, you check a point, you may have a job or not, depends how you do on your matrix. Then there are power brokers. Mm-hmm. These people never try to work in silos because they know that the money and power are more connections you make between the silos. And these people consciously join between the industrial, military, and business world. Mm-hmm. And then they are last really powerful people which move the power brokers, which we don't know their names. They are really moving the global economy. And these people have a real power. That's what it really.
Sometimes we know their names. Sometimes we don't.
Bill Gates, period. Yeah. But if you look, I look at the same list. We don't know really names of huge billionaires. So that's, I think, the structure.
I don't know. I'd have to think about. I mean, it's. I don't know. I mean, what I've charted and what I've tried to understand and put out is the way in which influence and power are operating today and how that's changed. And of course, those power brokers are how they're operating says a lot about income inequality, because the policies that they have promoted have led to income inequality, have led to this state of affairs. But there's a ton of new money. That's a ton of new money, as we've said. That's just lurking around, waiting to be spent. And I think that's a lot of what we have to look at. And that's where the nexus of policy and money comes together, but in very subtle, very often in subtle ways that we haven't thought of. So no, I don't think it's enough just to figure out who has all the money. We have to look at how they're operating and how the people around them are operating and the organizations that they're setting up and the building blocks. I mean, it's basically the building blocks at every level, the building blocks, how they fit together. We have to follow the players. It's too little and too incomplete to understand just the money. We have to follow how these players move around. We're going to get an incomplete picture if we don't follow the players.
The book is Unaccountable. Please join me in thanking Janine Wedel.